I would like now to introduce our student speaker, Dr. Yael Courtney. Yael is an outstanding scientist, a leader, and a wonderful teacher and communicator. Her path has not been easy. As a teenager, she formally emancipated herself from her parents in order to move forward in her life and in her education. This allowed her to attend Kent State University, where she excelled and graduated with the highest honors with joint major in psychology and cell and molecular biology while she worked to support herself throughout her studies. As a graduate student at Harvard in the PhD program in neuroscience, Yael carried out her dissertation work in the laboratory of Dr. Maria Lehtinen. Yael's research addresses an important and timely area of science. How do neurotransmitters, the communicator molecules in the brain, regulate the formation of the fluid that surrounds the brain and the CSF? And how does this change in disease or infections or other diseases? And I understand that paper was just published last week?
Yesterday.
In addition to her great science, she has been very engaged as a teacher, a communicator, and a leader in our community. She received awards for her outstanding teaching, and she has talked about her journey, about science, and about discovery for multiple audiences, a really important part of our duty now as scientists. She is now continuing her scientific journey at Stanford, where she will probe the interface between neuroscience and immunology. I look forward to hearing her talk today.
Thank you, Roz, for that generous welcome. Good afternoon, faculty, families, friends, and above all, my fellow graduates. Standing here today is surreal. We all climbed a mountain to wear these robes. For our class, that climb spanned a tumultuous era. We navigated not only the inherent rigors of doctoral research, but also the profound disruption, isolation, and pervasive uncertainty of a world reshaped by a pandemic. And somehow, none of that prepared me for how hard it was to format my dissertation. But that was just the final step in a climb that started long before grad school. My road here wasn't smooth. I left home young, moved through guardians and courtrooms, and never earned a high school diploma. I came out of that time with complex PTSD and a set of survival strategies that did real harm to myself and to people around me. More than one therapist admitted they didn't know how to help me. So when a guardian looked me in the eye and said, "Your two options are enlisting in the military or dying as a heroin-addicted prostitute," it was just the bluntest version of the dead end that really everyone already envisioned for me. I saw the same dead ends handed to others, to people I knew battling eating disorders and trauma and depression, treated like healing just wasn't in the cards for them. It became clear that the experts either didn't believe the brain could heal or didn't care to find out. And I decided that if they weren't going to ask how the brain could heal, I would. I turned to the one place I've always gone for answers, which is books. I was working 60 hours a week at Wendy's, long shifts to build a financial safety net, and I didn't have a super clear plan for what came next. I considered really everything, wedding planning, musical theater, maybe a corporate job. But off the clock, I read everything I could carry home from the library. I read psychology, behavioral economics, genetics, memoirs of survival, searching for a crack in the story that the brain couldn't change. And I found this book on neuroplasticity. It was story after story of people who weren't supposed to get better, but they did. And I cried through every chapter, and I rushed to tell my Wendy's coworkers that maybe the brain could get better. And if it could change, then maybe depression and PTSD and chronic pain weren't life sentences. It was the first time that the possibility of repair felt within reach, and that was it. I decided I had to become a neuroscientist. So I got my GED, And then Kent State University took a chance on me. They gave me a lab bench, some trust, and the space to figure out what I was capable of. Pell grants made it possible, and programs like BP Endure, which is an NINDS diversity initiative, helped me grow. My two funded summers researching at WashU were my first chance to just do science full time, and I was in love. The rest of college was a grind. I worked late night bartending shifts. I'd close the bar and head straight back into lab to stain mouse brains for free, crash for a few hours, and then review notes for organic chemistry at 4 a.m. over Dunkin' coffee. And I kept going because I believed science can bring hope to some of life's darkest corners. That belief eventually led me here, to Harvard's program in neuroscience, where foundational discoveries were made and continue to be made, and where I had the chance to build on that legacy by pursuing my own big questions. Support from an NIH training grant, the NSF, and an HHMI Gilliam Fellowship, a program focused on inclusive excellence, let me teach undergraduates, exchange ideas with peers, and study how maternal exposures can alter brain development at the molecular level. To the Penn leadership, thank you for listening and for advocating and ensuring we had what we needed. To my Penn cohort and to every student in the Division of Medical Sciences, you were the Zoom squares that reminded me I wasn't alone, even in the thick of a pandemic. You never made me feel foolish for being completely lost in electrophysiology, and you always showed up with curiosity and humor and heart. DMS programs teach us to tackle complexity, to question dogma, and to keep people at the center of every experiment, traits the world needs in its next generation of scientists. Before we look ahead, it's worth taking a moment to recognize what it took to get here. Not just the breakthroughs, but the failures, the long hours, and the conversations that turned our confusion into clarity. We all leaned on each other through fellowship deadlines, troubleshooting calls, and late-night Slack messages. Everyone here earned this moment, and the persistence, creativity, and grit behind it deserve to be seen. Yet, even as we toiled in our labs, a concerning shift was happening beyond these walls. The public trust in the science that we dedicate our lives to was starting to erode. Pew surveys show that trust in scientists has dropped sharply since 2020, and now only about half of Americans see science as a mostly positive force. We can't ignore this. If we want science to remain a public good, we have to treat public trust as something we earn. And as much as misinformation and political polarization have contributed to this divide, institutions like Harvard share some of the blame. When science is only ever communicated in paywalled journals or behind university gates, people feel locked out of the systems they fund. Much of what we do is funded by the public. From grants to core facilities to the stipends many of us relied on, taxpayer dollars make this work possible. We therefore owe not just good science, but clear and honest communication. Science is not partisan. We chose this work to heal, to discover, and to serve. We're here because knowledge can save lives, and because someone, somewhere, is waiting on the answers you are working to find. So here's my call to action. How can we, as newly minted PhDs, help restore public trust in science? First, grassroots science communication. You don't need a podcast or a huge platform to make an impact. Just talk about your work. I study maternal-fetal drug transmission, and over the past year, I've had dozens of conversations in local bars, at airports, literally in an elevator yesterday. When people learn that substances like psychedelics and opioids can cross the placenta or be passed through breast milk, they listen and they ask questions. Some even ask for my paper when it's out. Like, I have a bartender in New York who I have his email address, and when my paper comes out, he wants me to email it to him because they care about science. People want to understand if we're willing to meet them where they are, the same way someone once met me when I had never held a pipette. Second, be transparent with the press. When journalists reach out, try to make accuracy the priority. Share your caveats and say, I don't know, when appropriate. Research shows that acknowledging uncertainty builds our credibility, and ask to review the article before it goes live if you can, and make sure it's accurate and represents what you said correctly. And finally, it's important to connect and stay connected with the people who make the rules. Invite legislators and local officials to tour your lab, translate your work into kitchen table language, and testify when bills are drafted. Some of us will go further, run for office and shape policy from the inside, organize our workplaces. Whether you stay in academia, teach, build a startup, work in policy, you carry science with you, And every one of those roles is critical for community building. We can't only act when science is under threat. We need to be building support networks even when things aren't bad so that science can reach farther, help more people, and have lasting impact. Policy is shaped by the voices that show up, and scientists have to start showing up more. These steps won't fix everything overnight, but we don't have to give up the conversation to misinformation. Imagine if every graduate here had one science chat every week with someone outside of academia. That's 8,000 conversations a year. Imagine a generation of Harvard PhDs who count impact not in citations, but in how many communities we reach. We're already experts in perseverance. We've handled lab shutdowns, tough reviews, failed experiments, and the slow uncertainty that always comes with long-term research. We can take on the challenge of rebuilding public trust too, because people deserve to understand the science their lives depend on. So class of 2025, let's carry the wonder of discovery beyond this quad into living rooms, classrooms, bars, and Ubers. Let's do the science and make sure everyone sees why it matters. Congratulations, thank you, and let's get to work.